Leia here from leiafirstsci.com/MCAT, and in this video, we'll look at the autoionization of water. Water is a very common and very unique molecule that you'll study in chemistry. If you try to understand the properties of water, one question you have to ask yourself, is water an acid or is it a base? Water, or H2O, can spontaneously break down to give you H+ and OH-. Now think about your acid-base definitions. An acid is something that will donate an H+ in solution. Well, we have that right here. The Arrhenius base is something that will donate an OH- in solution. Or the Bronsted-Lowry base is something that's negative or partially negative that can pick up an H+ in solution. And we have that as well. So it's not so much a question of is it an acid or a base, but rather when does it act like an acid and when does it act like a base? H2O is a good example of something that is amphoteric and amphiprotic, two words that are often confused with each other. Amphoteric tells you about a molecule that can act as both an acid or as a base. But not every molecule acting as an acid or a base will accept or donate protons, which brings us to the second definition of amphiprotic. It has the word proton in it because this refers to a molecule that can both donate and accept a proton or an H+. Let's take a look at what happens when we have two water molecules next to each other. We'll show the purple water molecule using one of the lone pair of electrons on oxygen reaching for the green hydrogen on the second water molecule. Hydrogen can only have one bond, so when the red electrons grab the hydrogen, it has to let go of the other bond, and those black electrons will collapse onto the green oxygen, breaking the hydrogen away from the green oxygen. We show equilibrium arrows because it's a reversible reaction, and then we see the products with the atoms drawn exactly where they started, but now the purple water molecule has the green hydrogen atom attached with a red bond. It has just one lone pair, and a quick formal charge calculation shows that it has a charge of +1. The green water molecule is now just an oxygen bound to a hydrogen with its two initial green lone pairs, and now a third lone pair in black where the hydrogen broke away. A quick formal charge gives me a -1. So which one was the acid and which one was the base? We'll use the trick of which is more positive. We'll pair up the purple groups and the green groups. And notice that with the purple groups, the water molecule on the left is neutral. Hydronium on the right is positive. Positive is more acidic, and neutral is the more negative one compared to +1, making it basic. So that means this is my base, and hydronium is my conjugate acid. When comparing the green species, the one on the left is neutral, the one on the right is negative. Neutral is more positive when compared to -1, and the more positive makes it the acid. The negative hydroxide is therefore going to be the conjugate base. But water doesn't have to react just with another water molecule, it can also react with acids and bases in solution. For example, if you dissolve a strong acid like HCl in water, it'll break apart to give you H+ and Cl-. A water molecule will then use its lone electrons to reach for and grab that H+, and that'll give you an H3O+. If H3O+ is a conjugate acid, then water started out as a base. Now for example, if we dissolve a strong base in water, like NaNH2, this will break apart to give you Na+ and NH2-. The amide is a very strong base, and when dissolved in water, nitrogen will use one of its lone pairs to grab a hydrogen off the water molecule. That will give you NH3, ammonia dissolved in solution, plus OH-, which is a base. So if we look at the role of water in this reaction, H2O goes to OH-. If OH- is a base, then in this case, water is acting as an acid. So look at that, water acted as a base, gave us a conjugate acid. Water acting as an acid gave us a conjugate base. But in this video, I want to look specifically at water's ability to break apart. If we look back at the initial reaction, H2O will be in equilibrium with H+ and OH-. Because it's an equilibrium reaction, we need a way to calculate the ratio of reactants to products. We need an equilibrium expression. So we'll write the KEQ is equal to products over reactants. In this example, the products are H plus and OH minus, and the reactant is water. But don't forget the phase of each reactant and product. Water is liquid, H plus and OH minus are dissolved in solution, making them aqueous, but you can only include concentrations in an equilibrium expression. Solids and liquids drop out. And so the KEQ of the autoionization of water is written as the concentration of H plus times the concentration of OH minus. And this is called the KEQ of water, or W, simply written as KW. The equation that you have to know is that KW is equal to the concentration of H plus times the concentration of OH minus. At room temperature of 25 degrees Celsius, this will equal to 1 times 10 to the minus 14. One thing to keep in mind is that H plus dissolved in water will be picked up by another water molecule to give you H3O plus. So if you see this written as H3O plus and OH minus instead of H plus, it's the same exact thing and the calculations are the same. This is a very useful equation if you're trying to find the pH of a solution. So for example, if I ask you to find the pH of a neutral solution at 25 degrees Celsius, what you have to recognize is that in a neutral solution, the concentration of acid is going to equal the concentration of base. If you have more protons, it'll be acidic. If you have more hydroxide, it'll be basic. They have to equal each other for the solution to be neutral. And so we set up the expression KW is equal to the concentration of H plus times the concentration of OH minus, which is equal to 1 times 10 to the minus 14. But how do you solve an equation with two unknowns? The key here is to recognize that even though they're unknown, if they're equal to each other, I can call the concentration of H plus X and the concentration of OH minus X. And so I'm solving for X times X, or simply X squared, is equal to 1 times 10 to the minus 14. Take the square root of both sides to isolate X, and then simply find the square root of 1 times 10 to the minus 14. To find the square of 10 to an even power, simply divide it by 2, and X, which is equal to the H plus concentration, which is equal to the OH minus concentration, is equal to 1 times 10 to the minus 7. Another version of this equation to know is the P of this entire expression. Remember that P of anything is equal to negative log of that thing. So to take the P of this entire expression, let's take it one at a time. The P of KW is equal to PKW. The P of H plus is equal to PH. The P of OH minus is POH. When you have multiplication and you take the P of that expression, it becomes plus. And that means PKW is equal to PH plus POH. And then the P of 1 times 10 to the minus 14, we're using the trick that I taught in the math video series by simply taking that exponent, negating it, so negative becomes positive, and that is equal to 14. And this is the second expression to know. PH plus POH is equal to 14. Now this is a very, very useful equation, because if you're ever given an OH minus concentration and you need a pH, or an H plus concentration and you need a POH, you simply take what you have, take the P of that, so you get your pH or POH, and then do 14 minus what you have to find the other one. Let's go back to our previous example and find the pH of a neutral solution. If pH is equal to negative log of the H plus concentration, or negative log of 1 times 10 to the minus 7, we'll use that trick again, and that gives us pH is equal to 7. Now, if we want to use this to find the POH, we simply set up pH plus POH is equal to 14. Rewrite this equation using what we know. 14 minus the pH equals the POH, and 14 minus 7 is equal to 7, which just goes to prove that in a neutral solution, the concentration of H plus and OH minus are the same, and the pH is equal to the POH, so that neither is stronger than the other, because if the acid was stronger, you'd have an acidic solution. If the base was stronger, you'd have a basic solution. Be sure to join me in the next video where I show you how to use my pH wheel to find lots of different calculations based on one or two given values in a question. You can find this entire series along with my practice quiz and cheat sheet by visiting my website layerforsci.com/MCAT acid base. Are you stuck on a specific MCAT topic? I offer private online tutoring where I focus on your needs to strengthen your individual weaknesses. Tutoring details can be found using the link below or by visiting my website, layerforsci.com/MCAT tutor. Are you overwhelmed by the sheer volume of information required for the MCAT? Are you worried that lack of a proper study plan and low MCAT score will prevent you from getting into medical school? My new ebook, The MCAT Exam Strategy, a 6-week guide to crushing the MCAT, will help you formulate a concrete study plan by helping you figure out where you stand now, identify your goals, and figure out what it takes to reach them. And it's yours free when you sign up for my email newsletter at MCATExamStrategy.com. By signing up for my email newsletter, you'll also be the first to know when I have new videos, MCAT study guides, cheat sheets, tips, and so much more. The link again, MCATExamStrategy.com.